Rolling.
Tak ahoj, všichni vás tady vítám. Mám tu dneska speciální hosta, vysíláme z Gregu City, ale změníme se prostor trošičku, že tady probíhají přípravy na Canafest, pobíhá tu spousta lidí, tak aby jsme měli klid, tak jsme si zalezli sem. A teďka dovolte, abych vás uvítal, představil sebe, Michal Otivka, tady z Gregu City. A dnešní téma je seminář, osvětlení, důraz hlavně na LEDky, pěstování pod LEDkama, co to LEDky jsou, jak to funguje a úvod. Řekl bych, jedna z firm, jestli ne nejlepší, tak jedna z nejlepších na českém trhu, Lumatec. A tady Marko, jeden z šéfiků, ten to rozumí nejvíc. Musím se na začátek omluvit, chtěli jsme to udělat živě jako webinář. Problém je ten, že mu změnili LED, kolegové mají COVID, prostě složitá situace, tak jsme to vymysleli ještě líp. My to natočíme dneska pro vás. Odvysílá se to v čase toho webináře, to video bude pro vás dostupný na Czech Cannabis TV. A jak poběží to video, tak vy můžete psát otázky, všechno, co by vás zajímalo. A my pak uděláme druhou část, takový jakoby dodatek, kde na co nezvládneme zodpovědět dneska, teď a tady, tak pak uděláme druhý speciál s těma vašima otázkama, s mýma otázkama, vlastně jako i druhý navazující pokročilej level, jo. Takže děkuji vám za pozornost, myslím si, že to bude stát za to a předávám slovo tady Markovi z Lumateku. Man, thank you very much.
Hello everybody, thanks Michael and all of the friends of Gregu City for attending the webinar, which I understood already. Michael explained the reason why we are doing it this way. I apologize not to be direct, but I'd be happy to reply directly at the interchange we will have after this brief webinar. Today we're going to talk about light in horticulture. So basically, talking about some basic things that we need to consider when approaching lighting in horticulture, and also some tips when it's time to consider some specific products for your growing environment, especially with a focus on LEDs, as we are now living the LED revolution that started pretty much last year, I would say, beginning of 2020. We are in the real middle of it, and this also imply a little change of our mindset, right? Because was quite different when there was only HID solution on the market and we were used to talk about wattages, lumens and other concepts of this kind, and with the LEDs it brings also a wave of new concept and things we would like to explore a little bit more today. So basically, like starting from very beginning, describing what is light, right? So as you may already, most of you know, it's an electromagnetic radiation that it's basically made of photons. And what is interesting in this context is the spectrum that is to be considered in horticulture for the plant needs in the several stages of its life cycle. And a little consideration of what was used to happen in the past. So, as you can maybe see on the display or on the presentation that could appear, there's a difference between the human perception, what the eyes can see, and what is it's interesting for horticulture proposing. That is basically what the plant can use of the light. And the parameters are not really too different, so basically there's a slight coincidence of what the eyes can see and what the plant can use, but in fact when we are approaching horticultural lighting we are considering a bigger spectrum of light than what the eyes can see. Why am I saying all this? Because until a very few months ago I would say there was this use of considering the lumens to describe the efficiency of a light. The lumens is a unit of measurement that is based on the candela, which is basically describing what the human eye can perceive. And it was partially useful because, as I said, there is a part of the part, so the photosynthetic active radiation that the plants need, that is also included in the human eye spectrum. But in fact, we are missing, we are leaving outside some other parts. So nowadays, the lumens is not the most appropriate measurements we want to consider when describing the efficiency of a light. So, and especially when we're talking about light in horticulture, we want to focus on the photons, which is basically the particle we are sending to the plant, and that the plant is absorbing, and together with CO2 and water, it uses to make the photosynthesis, so it to activate the metabolism that is for all the light, for all the stages of the life plan. So basically, when we are using artificial light for horticulture, what we are doing, we are sending a flux of photons to the plant, and the plant absorbs it, most of it, and use it for photosynthesis. So it's we measure the light spectrum in nanometers, and as I said before, there's what the human eye can see is between 400 and 700 nanometers, but then we will see now in this presentation that for the plant needs, there's some more factors we want to consider, not only what we can see. So most of these of the light that we receive also from the sun is actually received by the plants, and part of it is reflected or is just penetrated. So you can see like a little more description of the light, the electromagnetic spectrum, considering the sunlight, that of course is the most complete reference that we have. And you may have heard about ultraviolet light, UVA, UVB, UVC. And this is in fact the part that is below the 400 nanometers of wavelength that the human eye can see, and it has some consequence, some use in the horticultural sector, and especially the UVC is used as a pesticide, and the UVA, UVB is a supplementary lighting that can stimulate the production of, in our case, the production of flowers and cannabinoids, but it's basically activate the metabolism, so especially the stem elongation. Then between the visible spectrum, we will see it later, then we have also the far red, that is on the other side, like if we consider it, we got 400 and 700 nanometers of the spectrum of the wavelength, that is what the eyes can see. Just below the 400 is UVA and ultraviolet, and above 700 is far red, infrared, and thermal. That is what we cannot see, but it's also useful in horticulture. The far red, we were talking before with Michael, especially, it's now one of the, let's say, the hot theme in horticulture, because it's the part of the spectrum in which there is more to be discovered and to be installed in this sector so far. So when we are the photons, just a little more focus on the photons, there are packages of energy that we are sending to the plant, and it activates the photosynthesis as we said before. So what is going on now with the LEDs is that instead of using the concept of lumens that indicates what you can see, we are using concepts such as micromole, PAR or PPF. Micromole is the unit of measurement of photons. Normally you use micromole per second, that is basically the amount of particles that you are sending to the plants per second. The PAR is basically stands for photosynthetic active radiation, or PPF, photosynthetic photon flux. It's basically indicates the same thing. So what we want to consider when using LEDs is the exact amount of photons that we are sending in a specific amount of time, because that's what we need to consider. As we are imitating, we are replacing the sun, we are still, the function is still the same, we want to activate the photosynthesis. So, and photosynthesis is essential from zero to, from the very beginning, from germination to the very end of the flowering period. So, What's going on now with the LEDs? It's not only we are able to understand exactly what we are doing in every moment, so we can also measure the PPF and the micromoles on HID solutions such as HPS, NH or CMH products, the lightings. But the LEDs have proven to be much more efficient. There is a much more homogeneous diffusion of the light spread, and this, of course, if you increase the light intensities, then you can expect to have a faster metabolism of the plants. That means that you will have the needs of adding, you will possibly need more water, more gas exchange, like especially CO2, more transpirations. You will the LEDs are also sending less heat to the plant, and you may have to increase the you will always have to pay attention of temperature, of course. So you may have to watch out also the ventilation. It's not something you need to totally forget about, because it's always an artificial growing environment and you need to observe what the plants need. So of course then we can go much deeper into the description of the wavelength and how the photosynthesis work, but the idea of today was to give like some handy advice of how to drive yourself between the several lighting solutions that are nowadays on the market. So, as we are saying, micromoles per second indicate the amount of photons you are sending to the plant. And this is basically talking about light intensities and light quantity. But when we are sending photons, it's important to bear in mind that the photons, they are just not all the same, because some photons belong to a specific part of the light spectrum of the light, so they are more useful for the determining stages of the lifetime of the plant. So if you talk about micromoles per second, you know what you're doing, like at a very short term, a short period of time. But as we were talking before with Michael, it's more important to talk about DLI, so the daylight integral, which means the total amount of light that you are sending during the day to a specific plant. So this is to be like very accurate in your needs with your growing environment. You want to do some little maths of this kind to be sure that you are delivering exactly the right amount of light and in terms of quantity and quality to the plants to develop in the best possible way in all of the different stages. So there's a way also to calculate the daily light integral according to the micromole, which is basically multiplying the micromoles that you are sending per second on a specific surface, so the PPFD, which is a micromole per second per square meter, and then calculating in on 24-hour period. In this way, then you will have a much more accurate use of the light for the plant to be developed in the best possible way. So, yeah, this is important because, of course, each plant has a different present different characteristics. So that's what we call, like, we can talk about photoperiodism. That is basically the response of the plant to a certain amount of hours of lighting. In our case, we want to consider long day plants such as cannabis. But of course, there are the other kind of plants that are not sensitive to the amount of light, the neutral plant, or even that require shortest amount of light. We need to be careful with the very powerful lighting that are now on the market, because you can have like a light that is too weak that can force some phototropism, so this natural tendency of the plant to go chasing the light. But if you're doing the other way around, if you're delivering too much light, you can also create some disorder to the bed, because you will on one side stimulate photosynthesis, but if you do not provide also correct amount of water and CO2, it can just generate some disorder and unexpected result in your harvest. So we're talking about the quantity so far, but just to focus a bit more on the quality, what I was describing before, the light spectrum. Most of the time we are often asked, like, well, what is the specific application of a particular part of the light spectrum? So I was saying before that all the ultraviolet part of the light spectrum is what we cannot see, that stands below 400 nanometers. And this is mostly used for disease and pest controls, activated defense mechanism, and generally like stimulating the metabolism of the plant. But what sure most of you already know, if you have used in the past an HID solution, such as for example the metal halogen lamps, MH lamps, that are more performing on the blue and the greens, that are the parts of the light spectrum that are more indicated for the vegetative phases, just to keep it simple, no? When it's time to choose a particular light. And of course, it's not only stimulating the growing, but that's what is mostly to bear in mind when considering a specific light. Then starting from the yellow to the orange and the red is where you want to be sure that you have this kind of light spectrum quality. When facing the last weeks of vegetative, some people is already changing the light spectrum with the HID solution or with the LEDs, but especially with the flowering period. This happened in the past with the HID solution. You need to be sure that you have these alternates of MH for the growing period, HPS for the flowering period. Then just a little bit before the LED revolution, we got the CMH on the market, ceramic metal halogen lamps, with the arc tube and the basin in ceramic, and still belonging to the HID category. And they did present a very complex light spectrum, more similar to the sun compared to the sunlight, compared to MH and HPS, but not as complete and as also more accepted, let me say, than the LED spectrum that we can appreciate nowadays. So basically, like making a little summary, we got light quantity on one side, light quality, so basically the amount of photons and the different kind of photons according to the light spectrum that we want to consider in horticulture. So now I was saying that LEDs revolution are taking over. So why is this happening? Why are LEDs solutions better than other HID solutions that were on the market and that still are being used and they are still being chosen by a lot of growers? So basically, you can say, of course, the LEDs. First things that come in mind to everybody is the power consumption. This is of course one of the advantages that you have in using LEDs. But this is just an initial one, because the light diffusion is much more complete and much more homogeneous than what happened in the past. Also using the best reflector that you can find on the market with some HID bulbs. Especially when you have the bar, the spider bar solution, such as the Zeus 600 Pro, you can guarantee that you are delivering this much more homogeneous amount of photons compared to other HID solution in the past. Then it's also generates much less heat than an HPS. Heat can cause a lot of problems in a growing environment. And this also allows the light to be much closer to the canopy top. So this is something that it's almost can be like twice closer to the plant than what was happening with the HPS without creating without creating problem to the crop. Then is the lifetime of the wall fixture. Normally LEDs, especially in our case, we offer it's the market leading warranty condition on LEDs with the Zeus range. We offer 5 years warranty time, and we also indicate the lifetime of the device is about 60,000 hours, which is way more than what was happening with the HPS bulb, MH bulbs that you have to replace basically every year, depending also on the use and depending also on the grower, of course, because in the end of the day it's also in the grower experience. Then the light spectrum is the light diffusion is very complete, but it's also the light spectrum is touching all of the needs of the plants. In our case, we will launch the UVA and UVA and UVB bars in possibly in January 2022. But at the moment, you can appreciate on our website www.lumatech.lighting.com. You can check the specification sheet of all our LED lights, and you will appreciate that the light spectrum is very complete and guarantee perfect results from day one to the artist. So especially the Zeus Pro line is much more performing on the red infrared spectrum, and we have included just now with the ATS Pro. Sorry, I need to correct myself. With the Zeus Pro line is more performing on the red spectrum of the light, and it's just now with the ATS Pro that we have included also some far red diodes. Just for those who may be interested, because that's another question that I am always asked about the diodes. We use a combination of white and red diodes, and this is because they have different efficiency, all the diodes, that maybe we can talk later more in detail, but it's the combination of the two diodes in quantity and quality terms that provide that such a complete light spectrum that we can offer at the moment. Then also some consideration with the previous HED solution, like for example MH, as we said before, more indicated for vegetative part, or also fluorescent bulbs were often used for conservative purposes, especially for clones. Nowadays the LED technology is also taking over these needs. But still, they are still present on the market and represent a very quality solution when needed. So, I don't know if you can see it here on the graphic, it just may give a much more clear example of the light spectrum. Here we have the light spectrum of the Zeus 1000 Extinct BPFD CO2, and then we got the light spectrum of HPS and MH lamp. You can see by yourself what's the difference and how the LED is much closer to the sunlight solar spectrum. So yeah, are there other things that we can consider that between comparing LEDs and HEDs? We talk about the light spread, the spectrum, the heat, the durability and reliability, and in case of Lumatech also warranty condition, less consumption, and there's also you will find more and more low wattage models availability. At the moment our lowest wattage device is the ATS Pro 200 watt, that is indicated for a small growing environment up to 80 per 80 centimeters, and of course you can grow closer to the canopy plant. I visited many industrial commercial premises, and sometimes I even seen the flower touching the diodes, which is something I strongly do not recommend. But let me also say that I've seen it, and I didn't see any particular problem with this. Still, we don't recommend to be that close. We also recommend to maintain a distance between 30 and 40 and 50 centimeters from between the light and the canopy. So what's the only bad things about LEDs? Well, as you already know, it's the initial cost. But if you look at it in a financial perspective, It's true, they are more expensive device, but on a long term, if you combine the electrical consumption plus the needs of replacing the bulb, also replacing the reflector, which I know that most of the growers don't do, but that's also the advice that we should give, that reflector, they are not, don't last forever. No, you want at least to give them a clean or to change them every 2, 3, 4 cycles, every 1 year. So if you look at after a few cycles, the initial investment on LEDs is compensated briefly after 1 or 2 cycles compared to LCDs. And now getting a bit more into our offer at Lumatec, as you may know, we have launched last year ZU 600 Pro, and together with the other LED products of our range. And you may have also heard of the improvement we have done this year. Let me just explain to you what happened, because this may have created a little bit of confusion. Basically, the first model of the ZUs was coming with a diodes bar. They were covered with a transparent acrylic cover. We have removed it because even though it was guaranteeing a little bit more protection of the diodes, we have tested the clear silicone glue instead. That is basically what is being used in the industry. This guarantees the lifetime of the diodes, and it also increases the anti-corrosion of the diodes bar itself. Then we have lowered the aluminium, the purple aluminium's border, and this way we can obtain a slightly more efficient device, so passing from 2.7 to 2.9 micromol per second. This is applied to ZUSIS and applies also to the ATIS range, the ATS Pro range that is now available. The difference in this case are not only the diodes bar presentation, but also the fact that you can now control the ATS Pro with our control panel or other control units that you may have. In the case you have some control universal controllers that use Ethernet 0.10 volt port, we also have created a cable that can connect the first unit to the controller. Then you will still need the daisy chain cable to put them in a daisy chain. And plus, one thing that we have with the ATIS standard range is that the IP was either growing, but now that we have the reason for this is that the dimmer was included in the driver, and for this reason we couldn't get the IP65. Nowadays the dimmer is exactly the same of the ZUs, so you can the IP is now IP65, one of the top in the industry, and now you can also put them in chain if you like. Still, the ATS are more thought about for smaller spaces, from 60 to 60 per 60 to 1 per 1. Then we got the ZU 600 ZUs 465 Pro for up to 1.2 per 1.2 growing spaces, and the 600 that is optimized for 1.4 per 1.4, and now being released in 2 weeks is going to be the ZU 1000 Pro. It's going to be one of the biggest footprint LEDs on the market, 2 meters per 1.5. That is coming just after the ZU 1000 Extreme PPFD CO2 that we talked, we mentioned before. It's a more experimental light for advanced growers. We recommend the use of CO2, and in this case you can cover a 1 per 5 footprint area. In the case you don't want to use CO2, we just recommend to increase the distance from the canopy top, and you will cover a 1 per 8 per 1 per 8 footprint instead. So, I don't know if Michael, you want to ask me something more in detail, or if I should...
Yes, we have a different question, Michael. No, I just have a few questions, but maybe if it's too much, we will involve it in the second part, or the questions which you can or won't answer. Mm-hmm. Briefly, let's solve it now, and the rest we can postpone.
Sure,
the second video. Yeah. Just starting from the beginning, because I didn't want to interfere, can you tell us just a few sentences about Lumatec? It's an English company, or?
Yeah, sure. Well, Lumatec is born in 2004 in United Kingdom, and at the very beginning, everybody knew it. Until 2019, everybody knew Lumatec for the digital. digital ballast, right? Was the first brand bringing the digital ballast on the market that represent a real revolution compared to most of the products that were available for horticulture back in that time. And since then, the company was born in the United Kingdom and started being very famous and recognized in the English market. Then slowly achieved more respect and consideration in the European market. Nowadays, we are proud to say that we are present in more than 50 countries where we work directly, that we have strong and reliable partners such as GrowCity that maybe help us also exploring and opening new markets as well. And in 2020, we have designed and released our LED range. The company is still based in UK, but we have now the main warehouse is in Portugal. The product, for those who are maybe wants to know, because sometimes we are also being asked, product are designed in Portugal and the United Kingdom and manufactured in China. On this, we want to be transparent because there are many brands in this market that ensemble the product in Europe, but still is produced in China. So we don't have any problem with this.
Okay, thank you. Do you experience any shortages, or what's the future with China deliveries production? Do you expect price increase, or how do you see the future in this segment?
It is very possible that there's going to be inflation, like for everybody.
So they should buy the light today.
That's maybe wait for the black week. Maybe it's a good price. But we have tried to contain these especially on raw materials. Mm-hmm. That's the aluminium, especially has increased of 15-20%. Not talking about the logistic cost. As you may know, now the cost of containers is crazy, and it's expected to go even worse in the Chinese New Year. So we are considering now, but still a long way. It's just an idea to try to see if we can get the production in Europe. Of course, that's a very big step. So we are now just evaluating this possibility. But yes, it's very possible. I've been asked also in the past week if it's going to be a price increase. At the moment, we are not considering, but it's very possible that it's going to affect everybody.
Okay. Now more the technical things. Which chips are you using in the lights?
Yeah, in the Zeus range, we are using 3030 HQ Lumileds. Lumileds, should I say? But it's the same as Philips, but as Philips doesn't want to be involved or associate with this sector, it's producing under the Lumileds name. That's for the white, 4000 Kelvins, and for the red, we are using Osram. In the Zeus range, Zeus Pro, the relation is 82% white and 18% red, while in the standard range is normally 93% white and 7% red. In the ADS Pro, we also have a far red that is still Osram, which for us, Osram and Lumileds, they are the most performing diodes, the most efficient as well, and the one with the longest lifetime.
When you compare to Lumileds, Samsung, Osram, and Chinese chips, how big is the difference, or how you see the benchmarking?
Well, we have been offered, of course, and we have considered also other kind of diodes, but at the moment, this, of course, for the red, I think at the moment, there's no concrete alternative to Osram. With the whites, most of people ask, why don't you use Samsung? Why? Because this is what being used the most. Still, also, our producing partner is one of the biggest horticultural lighting producers in the world, and I mean, they also agree with us that Lumileds it's higher quality compared to Samsung as well.
Okay. How did you choose the spectrum or the proportion? It's based on what's used in horticulture, on the market in general, or did some research, experiments, or how was the development of the light?
Well, this is something that maybe Martin would be most pleased. Okay. Martin Diana, my colleague, who is the product developer in Lumatech, But what happened in the product development, in the design of the product at Numatec, we normally collaborate not only with our electronical engineers in Portugal, but also with our partner in China. So that's why also it's taking long time before we release new products. Like for example, now the case with the UVA, UVB bars, we have announced them in springtime, and still they are not on the market. Because there's a long and serious time of analysis and tests that we do, and this relation, especially with the Zoo 600 Pro, has been studied exclusively by the Numatec team.
There are some lights on the market which are much more expensive, where you can choose different spectrum for grow and different spectrum for blue.
Yeah.
Does it make any difference, or can you achieve the same result with what's your point of view at this?
Well, at Numatec we are convinced that it is not that necessary to differentiate the two kind of spectrum according to the life stage, for many reasons. And one is that the plant doesn't stop the need for a complete light spectrum when it's on flowering stage or when it's on growing stage. It's still a plant, it's still a living being, so it just needs the complete full spectrum at all stages. And another reason is that this can create some unexpected results to the grower. When you leave this possibility to the user, you know, like when you're facing a growing environment, there are so many different parameters you want to consider. So if you are, for example, you are not paying enough attention to pH or electroconductivity, at the same time you are changing the light spectrum quality according to the particular phase, you can also create some unexpected results. So our philosophy is to proportion all the time the full spectrum, but just adjusting the intensity. So you will have a very complete spectrum in quality terms all the time, but just you will, let me say, play with the quantity, so with the intensity. This is something you can do with the dimmer, so dimming down to, for example, with our parameters normally are 25% for germination or clone, 50% for vegetative phase, and 100% of flowering phase. But this is you can do with the dimmer, or you can also do it by increasing the distance from the light to the plant.
When I have the light, what is the angle? What's effective angle which is shining?
It's 120.
120, so yeah. From this it should be...
Yeah.
Okay, so when I put it higher, the coverage will be
bigger.
Also,
as I said before, on the specification sheet on our website, we present the measurement of PPFD according to distance and just according to the instance, with several points, measurement points, so you can see also it is very normal that the light is much more intense in the center and then just decrease on the edges. But if you compare it LEDs and HED, that's another proof you can see for which the LEDs are much more recommended, that the loss of intensity is much more reduced on LEDs than on HPS or a CMH or an HBAS.
And imagine I buy more lights and I put them like in the row. We discussed, or you mentioned, the height from the crop, from the canopy. Would you keep the lights still in the same level, or you would prefer to move it up and down?
Well, that's really up to... We prefer to give like general indication, like of course myself or most of the people I talk with, we tend to adjust the distance according also on our experience. So especially maybe when it's a very last moment of flowering, you also are kind of forced for the growing dimension to decrease the distances. But yes, that's, you know, like to prevent people, because we know that if we say 30, 50 centimeters, the people will go 10. Yeah. So if we say 15, then it will just basically touch it. So that's, we just say it's a prevention indication.
And the one light is, let's say, this Zeus, it's 150 by 150.
Yeah, more, yeah, pretty much.
If I put more lights next to each other, still it's like 150-150 and the lights in the center, or it's
well, the ZEUS 600 Pro is much more indicated like 150-150, we indicated for vegetative part, but that's for the flowering, the light spread is much more complete for a white 1x4x1x4, we prefer to say using full cycle on a 1x4x1x4. Then of course if you put it together, what you will have, you will diminish the light decrease on the edges. So you can guarantee, like for example, if you're proceeding with sea of green, of course you can just proportion a very equal light spread in all the growing environment. But of course, just at the point below, just below the center of the light, we will always be more.
Which PFD level you are aiming to in this go? How many micromoles?
Well, we normally indicate back to the specification sheet. We are trying to highlight now where is the best distance to maintain from the canopy, and we normally consider like 700 micromoles. Yeah, as a PPFD.
In general, there on the market there is more types of light, but you have quantum boards, and you have these bar lights. Yeah. What is the difference, or why are the bar lights considered better? Maybe I'm wrong, but I consider them better and they are more used. What's the difference between them?
Well, the first one is the light diffusion, so the light spread. Sometimes in the quantum board you have the same, let's say, disadvantage of an HID solution, for example, that you will have much more intensity in the center and not much on the edges. Another thing is, in the case of you have some problem with the bar, especially with the ZEUS, you can, well, you know perfectly the ZEUS, so you know that when the ZEUS is working, if you just unplug one of the bar, the device will still work, and you can replace it, right? In the case of a quantum board, it's not always possible to replace the diodes. So it's a cheaper solution on the first side, but then it depends of your needs and what you use and what happens. So it might be a false saving.
Where do you see the future development with LEDs? Or where, it's one question, and second, where is the limit for the efficiency, or do you expect it increase? It was 2.7, 2.9.
Yeah. Well, at the moment, I think we are quite satisfied with the level of efficiency of our light, and especially with the completeness of the light spectrum that we are constantly relating and considering the other solution on the market. And we see the tendency is, of course, to declare higher and higher values of per second of efficiency of the light. Now I think we have already put on the market a lot of products, lots of different solutions. We have already improved them. I think for the next year, what we will be focusing more, apart from the UVA, UVB bars, it's more on the commercial sector. So this year we have launched in our catalog more solution for greenhouses, big scale project, not only HD but also LED. And what we want to focus is to develop some more efficient LED supplementary lighting for commercial products. That's for, and then one of the only new products in 2002 will be an improved version of the control panel. And in this moment, with the control panel, you can manage up to 400 ballasts or 100 LED lights. You can automatize turning on, turning off, sunset, sunrise, temperature variation controls, and we want to include more functions such as humidity control, air intraction, extraction, ventilation, and possibly also CO2. And that would be one of the development also to be sure that also the control panels are the same level of quality of the ZEUS and the other LEDs light, which are at the moment, they are one of the leading solutions in the LEDs.
I was surprised, I was just in Vegas from GBSCON, and I was making interview with guy from Ocean from Fluence, And basically, I was asking him about the UV light because they don't have it and they don't put it. Most of other people or lots of other people, they do it. And he said that they made some scientific research and the research, the test, they didn't prove the effect of UV. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It was their test. Do you have some results from testing this UV light or what's your experience or some scientifically based facts?
Yeah, well, what we surely know is UVC, they are used for pesticide, and UVA, UVB, they are like a supplementary light that should stimulate the metabolism of the plant and also increase the production in our case of flavonoids, terpenes, so you can achieve also better quality result in the end. Why is not so common to you to see UVA or UVB in IND? The lifetime of a UVA, UVB is much less than LED lights normally, and this will also increase the production cost of LED lights that we already know, especially like a brand like Fluence, it's quite expensive brand, no? If you want to compare with Lumatec. And plus also we are defining also the best legal mark to offer this product, because of course all the users, they must be aware of the danger of using this kind of light, because they are known they can cause cancer in case of exposure to of an exceeded amount of time. So this is something that I didn't have any concrete result. I don't have at the moment concrete result to share with you now, because we are still in development phase. So well, we had some prototype that was allowed to be launched, but we were not satisfied with it, so we are now hoping to have it released on January.
Okay. Recommended light plan when growing under the LEDs. Maybe specify even more. When you switch to 12 hours, would you go immediately to 100% or you would postpone it, or what's your suggestion?
That's something I've been talking with Boom. Of course, we always interface with those who use our lights. I've seen that there's a big number of growers that wants to start at the first 2 weeks of flowering with 75%, just going slowly. This is something that's really up to the grower's experience. Personally, I think it makes sense to not create such a strong, shocking change of light intensity. But at the same time, what we have seen is still that the LED light is much more accepted, let's say, compared to an HED. This is basically also because of the heat and of the more of the fact that we talked before that the light spectrum is much more complete. So you're not just delivering 100% of orange and red photons, but you are delivering the full spectrum all times. So as long as the plant has the condition to develop all the photosynthesis that is asked to realize, there won't be any problem with switching from 50 to 100%.
What's to do different under the LED? When you switch from HPS to LED, you want to give people simple advice. I don't know, I know that simple advice doesn't work most of the time, but if you should simplify it or a few points.
Yeah, well, that's something that happened, that there's it's an empiric consideration that many growers that pass from HED to LEDs, the first experience is not always the best. No? Sometimes there's also not enough yields results in terms of quantity. So of course it's different, it's not, I mean, if you've been growing all your life with an HPS and you switch to LEDs, you will have to think differently, you know, because if you have used HPS, it's very rare that you have been checking the micromoles and all the light spread. What we have seen is that most of the growers, they state that they have noticed an increase, an increased demand of the use of calcium and magnesium. This is something that we are paying attention to, but we don't have any specific rate, like we don't know exactly quantitatively speaking what's the additional request of calcium and magnesium when using LED compared to HPS. What we do see that it's to be considered is the possibility of using CO2, because of course the amount of light you are delivering now with LEDs is much higher, so you are calling the plant to develop faster and also like in bigger scale. Therefore, an additional supplement of CO2, it's most of the time a very accurate indication, a very good choice.
Temperature and humidity would be the same or different?
Well, of course, temperature it's the LEDs produce much less heat. So in this, you also save something in extraction devices and consumption. Which on the other side, especially I imagine when growing indoor in Prague during winter time, this is exactly something that you miss.
Russian winter. But I mean, if you have a thermostat and you want to set up some temperature, or different, which temperature you would consider to be the ideal one?
Well, that's just the same with HPS and LEDs. So I normally stay between, I try not to exceed 32, which is basically, you know, if I don't remember correctly, it's also Jorge Cervantes' advice, no suggestion. And then yes, with humidity, but also of course depends also on the geographical situation, but because of having less heat, it's also you will experience some changes than with the HLE. What I normally try to avoid is to be more than 40%, which is basically. But this is, oh, I don't know, this is more me, not about the quantity.
Yeah, okay. And EC? You would give higher EC, more nutrition?
Well, you can expect to have, as you are activating metabolism, to have a much higher demand of nutrients as well. But this, back to before, like, you know, it's not something I would consider recommending. Like, if you're using LED, you should consider increase the EC automatically or with some specific rating. So.
Okay, I think it's enough for today. We will get questions, we will prepare a few questions, we will screen the video, we will try to add subtitles, it would be better. And we can make the second part. Já myslím, že to stačí takhle. My pokusíme se udělat, že by tam byly titulky, abyste tomu rozuměli, to bude, ale jestli jste tam věděli, jak se to povedlo, jestli ne, tak ne, že jo. Sepíšeme naše otázky, sepíšeme vaše otázky, uděláme ještě druhý návazný díl, prostě s odpověďma, ať víme co nejvíc. Takže co vás zajímá, co tady nezaznělo, co vás napadlo, pište do komentářů, pište nám do zpráv, co nejvíc, že jo, my to dáme do kupy a půjdeme dál.
So thank you very much.
Thanks.
Do you want to send some message to our friends?
thanks everybody for watching this webinar, and I'm more than available for any possible question or doubts you may have. And thanks also for considering Lumatech for your growing solutions.
Super, no, ale byste chtěli Lumatech, tak si to napište. A jinak my máme dneska větší egg, máme tady nakazený sud piva od kluku z Konopexu, takže...
Very nice.
Děkuju. Čau.
Perfekto.
It's our friends from Konopex.
That's really deep.
Perfect, man. It was amazing. Thank you.